이들 만의 들판에 길이를 닥쳐온 고민을 담아 턱어난 구름에 그린 팔레트. 그리고 그때 밤 우리들 만의 들판에 홀로와 빛났던 순간을 담아 띵어난 꿈은 내 파고 물 위에서 You know the rules boom 비는 길에서 움직여 구구 일단 앞으로 뭘 위한 건지도 모를 벗어나 불을 벗어난 밤새도록 all night 비워내 내 맘속에 불 끄고 비웠던 꽃잎 밖에 떠올릴 게 없어 이 넓은 들판에
YouTube. If it weren't for you guys, I don't even know if I would know what's going on my freaking channel. What's up, Baggins? What's up, Scott? What's up, Crompton? I'm going to call you, what's the street? Compton Crompton? That's your new name is Crompton Compton Crompton. That's a tough one to say. You in the hood, Mr. Colin. What's up, Jason? Jason's here. Looks like we got a bunch of people. I saw Echo said something about I need to listen to some song or some band. Hopefully someone on the channel points it out or requests it or pays for it. Actually, even you could do that, Mr. Echo. The reason I was shaking my head is if it weren't for you guys, I don't know what's up. Hey, Kelly, join the chat. What's up, Kelly? It's good to see you at the live stream for once. It's a good thing. Actually, Kelly is like a wealth of knowledge when it comes to Prague stuff because I wouldn't know anything if she didn't. She writes me messages on Instagram and tells me stuff like Caligula's horse is coming to a Prague. Is it Prague Power? Is that what it's called? I can't remember the name of it. So she tells me all the stuff. We met up at the Leprous concert here in Columbus. I got to meet her and her brother, so it was really cool. She got to meet my wife because my wife went, so it was a good time. Welcome, Kelly. Hope you can stay a bit and see what we got here. I can't remember, Kelly, if you were the power metal type, but that's probably going to be the set tonight. I don't really know, but whenever Colin picks stuff, he picks power metal. So, yep, there it is. Power metal. Prog power, power metal. So anyway, what I want to say is, oh, it is the 200 stream. I forgot about that. I honestly didn't think about it. Are we supposed to do something for 200? You know what's really funny? It reminds me of Korea. They like count their relationship in days. So it'll be like 300 days. They do an anniversary, 500 days, 400 days. Just really funny. It's like counting days of your relationship shows how short relationships can be. Oh, the next one's 200? Okay. Maybe I'll think of that. Maybe I'll just like come on here shit-faced drunk or something. But the reason I was shaking my head is that I had no idea that the last stream was blocked. What the fuck, YouTube? Once again, YouTube, you just go above and beyond being fucking retarded. Me and Ryan McGill had this little back and forth chat comments in one of the videos because I mentioned something about how we're getting less and less views on every video. It's just really funny. Yeah, it's just kind of weird. So we were going back and forth about why, and it doesn't matter what I do, but I either get blocked for no reason whatsoever, or my videos don't. He had to type in the fucking Captain Morgan's channel for me to pop up. Everything else he typed in, fucking nothing came up that I've done. I mean, come on, he's a subscriber. My shit doesn't even come up for him. YouTube, what are you trying to do to me? So, I didn't know the video was blocked until someone just said it in the chat, because when they sent me the video, they always send me emails to every live stream I do, and it just says, you have done copyrighted material. It says, your stream is still visible, and this is not a strike, but just so you know, it's copyrighted. And it does that for each song that's on the stream. I got those emails this morning when I went to work. If the video gets blocked, you'll get an extra email that says, your video has been blocked because of such and such, blah, blah, copyright. I didn't get that email, so I didn't even think that the video got blocked until I just see it in the chat. So the reason I was like a minute or two late is I went to look at it. And for sure, that video is blocked. It's blocked because of the Opeth song. I'm like, are you freaking kidding me? So it's blocked because of the Opeth song. So I have to go and fucking dispute the Opeth song. I swear. Fucking YouTube, just get off my cock and just let me be. God. I'm sure this is going to get blocked. So Colin gets blocked like more than anybody else on the channel. So 100% this is going to get blocked and buried. Blocked and Buried. That's going to be my new band name. Blocked and Buried. That'd be a fucking... And I need to have like a singer that's like Amon Amarth for Blocked and Buried. Anyway, all right, so we're already 11 minutes in. I'm bitching. It's like seriously thunderstorming out. Well, not bad, but it was thunderstorming and raining. I had a really, really long day. It was just like nonstop busy as soon as I got into the office and all the way until like 5. I worked 2 extra hours. I hate working overtime at work, but I did. So let's get into this, and then I'll catch up with the chat while we're listening to the first song. Because you guys are talking a lot. I like it. There seems to be a lot of people here. We got 12 or 13 people in the chat, it says. Maybe some more will join once we get into this power metal stuff. So Colin Set says, blimey. So we got to hear you say that, Colin. That's why I want to do the video of the, you know, the little introductions that we do on Zoom and then put them on here. It'd be kind of cool. So he says, blimey. Hey folks, I hope you are well. Only 4 songs today, but the last one is a banger. Uh-oh, Manuel Romero is getting into everybody's head with these bangers. No real theme once again, let's just dive in. So the first song is Witherfall, and the band is called Witherfall, the song is called Tempest. We kick things off with one of my favorite new bands, Witherfall. These guys opened my last set, and here they are once again. Witherfall is like if you took Nevermore and Symphony X and some vocal parts from King Diamond and blend it until it's a power prog powerhouse of a band. Tempest is from their latest album released last year. The album as a whole deals with a myriad of themes, but mostly anger and torment. This song features some black metal, power metal, and some prog metal parts, and it flows perfectly. Special mention has to go to Marco Miniman on drums. He kills it on this song. Fucking Marco Miniman is badass. I think his personality is freaking quirky and almost like on the autistic like spectrum. But he's obviously very good at drums, which autism can give you that kind of special like side. All right, so here we go with Tempest by Witherfall. Ching! Might have to turn it up or turn it down. We'll have to see. Okay. Kind of an interesting beginning. Just read that Eve thought that I was a single guy in a dorm. I'm married and I own a house. Can you believe it? My wife's ugly as hell though, so you can ask Kelly. I like this rhythm. Yeah. Yeah, this is definitely an interesting kind of mixture. I like this guitar. Sounds kind of like Opeth a little bit. What's up, Sammy? Call me a hot piece of ass? I'll take it. You will bend to my will and you'll know all the reasons for your existence. Not a huge fan of the singing. What's up, Pyramid? Pyramid's the comedian of the group. I kind of like the heaviness of it, but it's definitely a little weird. I'm too quiet? Oh shit. Do I need to turn myself up?
Return! Sorrow as the tears flow deep. Wind whips the shadows as I lay the path of resistance. As waters never learn. Now it's all you can do, but so
I do like that.
While the vortex turns, when the storm comes rushing in.
I would never have guessed this was Marco Miniman. I don't feel like he's doing anything special, like Marco Miniman's doing anything special. Like, I would not know that it's Marco if you had not told me. Maybe that's a good thing. Cool bass part here. Exactly, Scott. It's become a thing, I think, to pick songs that I won't like. Ooh. Like this part. Dude, this is gonna be my favorite part of the song. I thought it was gonna go off, but it's just kind of like set the mood.
This is now the final.
Dude, I love that guitar there.
Yeah!
withering away into the witherfall.
When the storm.
Scott, do you like his voice? Because I thought you would not like his voice either. Sounded like Russell right there. I would agree with that. Not the worst I've heard, but it's definitely not making the song better. I want to see that live. Okay, so I'm gonna say the last part of that was the most impressive part. That guitar solo, if you want to call it a solo or outro, to me was the most impressive part of the song. To be honest, I don't think Marco was really anything special in that song. All he was doing was monster fills. Diggity, 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 diggity. It's not really hard. I can do that. And that's definitely not a good kind of example of Marco. It's one of the easiest things to do in metal drumming. I mean, the whole was like what you hear in Megadeth. Tornado of Souls, once again. So, yeah, I don't feel like, I mean, it wasn't bad. Obviously, it was good. Good drumming. It just wasn't like, when I think of like Marco Miniman, I think of like the Aristocrats and like, how he, just his ability to play with such joy and passion, and you can hear it even if you're not watching him, as well as his just technical prowess is fucking amazing. I mean, it's just absolutely amazing. The song was good, but he didn't do anything in there that I was like, holy shit, that was amazing. It just, to me, was pretty straightforward and fit the song. But that fucking guitar at the end, oh my gosh, I want to see that dude live. Who's the guitar player? The guitar outro there was fucking beautifully sick. So, we're having a tempest right now. Yeah. yeah. So I think, I would like to hear the guitar, see the guitar. Is there a live version of that? Cause I would like to see the guitar solo there or the outro. That'd be Jake Dreyer. He fucking smoked it at the end. And I liked his rhythms, if he's playing the rhythm stuff too. Very catchy, very tough, very rough, very in the pocket. Yeah. Jake Dreyer was the most impressive part of that song to me. And of course, the singer was the least apart. All right, let's get to the next one. This is Lalu. Lalu. Follow the Line is the name of the song. Lalu returns with a song from their second album, Atomic Arc. The last song we heard from these guys was The Chosen Ones and had more of a prog rock feel. This time we get some prog funk. That could be a nice little mix. I guess that's what I would call it. Follow the Line is a song about ants. Yes, ants. And let me tell you, it might be the best song about ants ever. Now this song is quite short at just under 4 minutes. Okay, hopefully that means the stream won't be interrupted like last time. Yet the video version wasn't taken down. What the fuck, YouTube? Again, what the fuck, YouTube? That could just be the name of the channel. Jens Johansson makes an appearance on this song with two keyboard solos, the second ending the song in an abrupt fashion. This album also features a different singer, Martin Lemar, who is more gravely than Damian Wilson's more smooth delivery. Okay, so here's Lalu with Follow the Line. Let's get into it, baby. Yeah. I can understand, it sounds like... Okay. Precision is so good. Yeah, this is gonna be a tough one between the two. I like the funky feel here more than the last song, but the last song had some great heavy riffage. Yeah, Kelly, since this is one of your first times here, you've gotta vote on your song list, as Ryan just did. Oh, is that it? Is it the end? All right, I guess it's the end. Yeah, this is going to be a tough one for me to judge because, again, this one was funkier and groovier and had more feel to it, but it would still, maybe because the keyboard, like, patch choice, it sounded a little borderline cheesy. But it was still good. Like, it was groovy. I liked it. But the first one had some fucking awesome heavy riffs. And if it wasn't for the last outro of that awesome guitar solo, I definitely would say number two, but I think because of that guitar outro, I'm going to say 1-2. But it's very close. It's very close for me. Very, very close. Yeah, Kelly, hope your dad's doing okay. let's see for the next song, because I think when we get to the banger is going to be like 80 minutes. We'll have to find out. Uh-oh. I'm sure you guys could guess who the next band is since they show up every time on the channel. And I like them. There's a lot of stuff I like about this band. This is Terra Maze. And they're cool because they actually don't let stuff get blocked on my channel, which is nice, which means I want to listen to them more. So thank you, Terra Maze. Blood of Fools. This is Dean, which Dean, I love his voice. I think he sings very well. Dean and the boys are back with a song from their most recent album. Okay, this song is very straightforward, but I think this is Dean's very best vocal performance. Dean, I cannot wait to hear this. We're both bald. Let's go. There is some allusions to the band Christian beliefs in the lyrics, but it's not preachy or off-putting in any way. Interesting. So I didn't even know Terra Maze was like really Christian. So that's the first to hear that. When you say this is off their most recent album, can you remind me again when that recent album came out? I'd be interested. So this is a 6-minute song-ish, and this is Blood of Fools by Terra Maze. Let's go. Have good catchy like stuff. Damn, Kelly. Fucking shit. Absolutely shit. Goddamn lies. Nice. I know, Kelly, it doesn't mean much coming from strangers, but for what it's worth, from a stranger, from strangers. And I think Dean sounds excellent on this. Absolutely excellent. Are they gonna have a good chorus here, Colin? I wanna hear a good chorus. Good rhythms here. Engineered very well. What up, Hera? It's goddamn lies. I like that he's a Christian saying goddamn, but he's probably meaning it in the rightful sense, not in the disdainful sense that we use it. Damn, Dean, you are a magnificent talent, bro. Beautiful. Fools don't get away. Now they belong to the night. Fools don't get away. fucking rock and roll, dude. Kelly, I actually was gonna say, I know you guys are gonna rip me for this, but I think this is the best song so far. Nice steely solo. Baggins has got jokes tonight. People are not getting it. Dude, this is a good song. I mean, I know it's more on the poppy end, but I like poppy more. Yeah, I could agree with that, Colin. Like, if it had a really strong chorus, it'd even be better. But I like it. I think this is great. Ryan. I'm sure Michael would be bored with the song, too. Because it's not going in enough places. Is that the end? Wow, that is the end. That was a quick 6 minutes. For a song that didn't really develop a ton, it kind of was in that like poppy kind of stream. That was a fast 6 minutes for me. And yes, I mean, for me, it is 3, 1, 2. I thought it was well produced, sounded really good out of all the songs. His voice is excellent, Colin. I can see why you think this is one of his best performances, especially when he goes high. I like the harmonies. Just a lot of passion, and I think that his the rhythms were very well done, which Terra Mays always does a good job at their like rhythmic section, setting the tone for the whole song. Again, if it did have like a better chorus, it would have gone from like really good song to really, really good song for me. But it definitely, I've told you guys this many times, on the scale of like technical versus poppy, which is the two ends of the spectrum, I'm gonna side more on the poppy side more than like the very technical side, I guess. Avant-garde side. So, we got Bryce in the chat. What's up, Bryce? Welcome. You've missed 3 songs already, but we're on the 4th song, which I guess this one's a banger. We're gonna find out how long this actually is. They are pretty simple, Baggins, but I would agree that they're not the most risky. But like I said yesterday, I felt like sometimes prog in general can just kind of fucking do too much. That's probably more of its issue with than anything versus being more poppy simple. Let's get to the last song since this is going to be a banger. We're at 40 minutes. So let's see what this says. This is also Witherfall, which is how we started this whole shebang. And the song is called And They All Blew Away. This is fucking 16 minutes long. You and Manuel Romero, who hasn't been around as much lately. He hasn't even turned in a set in a long time. He's got you guys giving these long-ass songs now. As long as it's good. But I said, anything over 9 minutes, when you start getting over 9 minutes, you better... better pay off for the extra fucking 10 minutes that you're playing. And we come full circle with Witherfall. This is the epic off the same album as the first one. As expected from the length, the song goes through various moods and styles, from beautiful acoustic guitar to crushing riffs from soul guitar player Jake Dreyer, who I swear is a younger Michael Romeo. I could see that. He was fucking sick. Although some of his sweeps were very Yngwie to me in that first song. Singer Michael Joseph hits some incredible notes in this song in both extremes of his range. Around the 10-minute mark, there is a little nod to Dream Theater with a riff that sounds very, very similar to the fast picking section from the opening of Dance of Eternity. Do you think they did that on purpose, or you're just hearing that in the song? You'll know it when you hear it. Also, fun fact, bassist Andrew Crawford used to be the bassist for Justin Timberlake. Which, to be a bassist or a player for any of these guys, like pop guys like Justin Bieber and Justin Timberlake, you gotta be fucking badass player. Like, anybody know who Tony Royster Jr. is? The dude is fucking phenom at, like, there's a video of him at like age 9 or 12 just beating the shit out of every drummer alive. And that's when he was 12, and now he's like 30. That dude is fucking playing for Rihanna. Fucking Rihanna. The dude's chops and ability and soul and funk and feeling is so beyond playing fucking My Umbrella, Ella, A. But he's doing it. Wait, is she the one who sings that? I don't remember. Anyway, I don't know all that shit. So he says, that's my set after 16 minutes. Thanks for being here. Let's get into this. I'm actually most excited right now to hear this fucking Jake Dreyer go off some more. So let's get to it. I agree.
The final line lies between what was said. It tells me what
30 minutes, seventh wonder.
Descending through the emptiness. All the while.
Yep, exactly, Scott. I'm sure that's why he's doing it. Definitely don't like the singing.
And nothing can stop.
Yep, he's right. What's up, Petey? Right in time for a 60-minute epic. I want to hear this guitar player. That's what I want to hear. That is Marco Miniman. This is Marco Miniman. Already much harder than the first song. Ooh. Holy shit, Marco. Colin, this is Marco Miniman. As soon as the singing stops, I'm in love with this song. That burns, that burns. Like a Harlequin Forest ending. Dude, this is totally Harlequin Forest ending. Dude, that's like Harlequin Forest ending. Did I say it a fourth time? yeah. I mean, I can't believe anybody said the first song was like Amazing Drums by Marco. It was basic. This is fucking Marco. Such a weird change there, though. I do feel like their transitions are not the best. Me too, to be honest. Me too. Okay, which one in the picture is drier? I have a feeling he's the guy with the blonde hair and long blonde hair. Third from the left. Last time you have failed me, I'll keep my I have a feeling the singer is the guy with the black reach. Hair. Am I right? And for every empty sacrifice or promise you won't keep, I lay it all out on the table. You leave me hanging on the line. Here's to every wasted. Yes, I can just kind of see it. That dryer gets some major poontang. I just said poontang. Surprise myself sometimes. And now the course laid out before me, no more promises to keep. It doesn't matter if in the end it doesn't justify the need. Yeah, exactly, Rhino. I was just going to say that. Like, this is not bad. I just don't like it when he goes... Ryan. You don't know that, man. We got fucking 20 minutes left. Ooh, Kelly likes this one too. Ooh. Yeah. Scott, I'm totally definitely getting a drummer bone. Marco is picking some serious ass on the song. Very good riff, but I want to hear Mr. Dryer just go off. Just means you have to go back, Kelly. Ryan, there better be. If there's not, that's a waste of 16 minutes. Are you saying this is the Dance of Eternity part? It's a cool part though. Crossing over. Something like that. I wonder if Marco ever says anything. He seems like he's the type that'd be like, yeah, your singing there kind of sucks. Like, Cookie Monster shirt on. Well, you must like Witherfall there, Ashley. Munchkins. Ooh, I love that. Sounds like Endless Sacrifice, not Dance of Eternity. Ooh. My God, what do we just go into? What'd you say, Baggins? Don't be saying shit you take back. I'm gonna say it now. This song is the quintessential hodgepodge of parts all put together. I don't feel like any connection in this song at all. All right, Baggins. Oh, yeah. Here's the Dance of Eternity part. Yes. I got it, Colin. Cool parts in this, but definitely not a song. Not cohesive at all. I like them if they make sense, like Change of Seasons by Dream Theater. Then it's okay. But Octavarium? No. I think it's the most overrated DT song, Bryce. I fucking hate it. And Dream Theater fans are like, Octavarium, you stole Octavarium. No. Never. Especially for a first time listen. That and fucking Dance of Eternity. Two of the most overrated DT songs ever. Oh, here we go. Jeff. That's it. Wow. Okay. So I'm just going to say it. For me, it's 3, 1, 2, and then a whole lot of nothing, and then 4. Yeah, this, I think this is a great way to kind of example what I was talking about earlier. Kelly, other people were making mention of, they like chaos a little bit and stuff like that. And for me, like, again, on the spectrum of music, progressive rock specifically, you have like your more Yes, Genesis kind of like melodic, you know, more poppy edge, not as technical songs. And then over here you have like your Meshuggah and your very like, just very technical, but avant-garde, chaotic, not good songwriting skills. And that's one of the reasons I've said I've liked Leprous, because I felt like Leprous, when I listened to their older albums, was like kind of over here, like very disconnected, not good songwriting. And they kind of moved a little bit more in the poppy edge, but like they blended still some good writing stuff. And I wouldn't say it's very technical, but it's just so well blended. Yeah, this song just to me was a bunch of shit put together that had no rhyme or reason. And outside of the fact that Marco's fucking amazing and that this guitar player's amazing, I think the bass player is good too. I felt like nothing in the song was very well put together as a song. It was just a bunch of parts that were fucking cool in a lot of ways, but had no connection to each other. And to me, that's just not a song. That's just a bunch of fucking parts put together. Cool, but okay, not, especially not for 16 minutes, not for me. I will say this, one of the things I want to say after hearing this, I think it's really, really difficult to be a good singer. And as much as I bag on this guy, because I don't think he's that great or I don't like it, to be a good singer, I think, is the hardest of all instruments in the band. It's just, and it's not even so much, and I'm not even talking about technically it's the hardest, because I mean, you could like, obviously getting that good at guitar is technically fucking tough. And so, like, I'm not saying it in that way, but to, like, be accepted as a good singer, especially in a rock, progressive sort of metal situation, it's just going to be few and far between. Like, I can count on, like, less than my one hand how many amazing good singers there seem to be. Devin Townsend is one of them. I think Sir Russell is. I mean, there are good singers, great singers, but, like, just, like, fantastic singers. It comes down to, like, tone, and if their tone, especially when it comes to this kind of music, it's going to be hard to find a tone that actually is good without it being, like, kind of annoying and cheesy. So, I mean, yes, in pop, you're going to find great singers because it's easier to be, like, sounding good in your tone when it comes to Broadway or that kind of stuff. But when it comes to this style of music, it's going to be tough to find, like, a really good singer. So as much as I just don't like these kinds of singers, I also understand, like, fuck, that's a one in a lifetime job that not many people can do and just pull it off. It's just really, really hard, which is, yeah, there's a few that could do it, which is why Devin, I think, is amazing, because the dude doesn't even fucking, like, he's not like a trained motherfucking singer, but he sounds so good. And if it wasn't for his singing, most of his songs would be boring. But because he sings so well, it just makes his fucking songs better. But anyway, that wraps us up for tonight. Thank you, Colin. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Kelly, hope you rock through it. My dad, obviously, we've talked about it, is not in that situation, but is slowly declining, which I don't know which one is worse, for his sake and our sake. But hang in there, and thank you for joining us. I think music is a great way to help you deal with shit, so it helps me deal with shit. You guys have a great one, and we will see you on Saturday and Sunday for Jason Gentry's double set, back-to-back. What is he going to pick? You better be ready, because I know, but you don't. All right, peace out. Have a good one. Later.